your skin, that shit is popping, girl. Body on 10, damn, you got it, girl. You gotta boss up, getting them checks, living your best. Racks up, oh. Keep walking with confidence. Effortlessly, you let them know who is in command. You just that and more, don't forget it. God work hard on you for sure. Lexus, Exodus, shout out to my exes.
Is Lexus Exodus, leader of the Black Woman Exodus. How are you guys doing? Like always, if you enjoy this content, please like and subscribe. Please share. Please say what's up to me in the comment section. Say what's up to me in the chat. Hey, y'all in the chat. Thank you so much for tuning in. Also, when you have a moment, please pause this video and follow the backup channel. It is called LexEx. That's LexEx. You can also find the link in the description below. Also, if you have any suggestions or any ideas for any new stories, feel free to share that to me to my Gmail. That is LexusExodusChannel@gmail.com. Also, if you bop into the intro song and you enjoy it, you can now stream it on all streaming platforms. That's right, you asked for it, so I did it. You can now stream the Lexus Exodus full intro song on iTunes, Apple Music, and Spotify. Special shout out to Iris for the Cash App. Iris, you are always so dope and are always supporting the channel. I appreciate you, sis, for sending that Cash App over the weekend. Thank you. Okay, so let's get started with an Ask Lex letter. This one is from X. X says, hi, Lexus. I love your content and I'm glad I came across your channel a couple of months ago. It really has opened my eyes to the ugly truths of lack of sin and has convinced me to divest. I'm going to be 35 in a few days and well-educated. I have both a bachelor's and master's degree, have a great career in education, and well-traveled. I traveled to and lived in a few countries throughout my 20s. I was in a four-year relationship and was engaged up until last year when my partner committed suicide. I've made peace with his death and now realize that marrying him would have honestly been a mistake. Not to speak ill of the dead, but he suffered from clinical depression, was a college dropout, and had a hard time holding down a steady job. I realize that I may sound cold and detached, but believe me, it took a lot of tearful self-reflection to come to terms with all this. Yes, prior to and during my relationship, I admit that I was the Holy Trinity, a pygmisha, mammy, and a mule. I'm ready to begin dating again with a fresh pair of eyes, but because of my age, I've really been hearing the loud tick of my biological clock. I've always dreamed of having at least one child in wedlock, but fear that having to start over again when it comes to dating and waiting for marriage will leave me childless. If I'm not engaged or married in the next 2 years, I've given a lot of thought to whether I should come or become what's called a single mother by choice. This is when a woman decides to have a child on her own through the insemination of donor sperm or adoption. Although this option means that I will not be pumped and dumped, it would mean that my child would statistically join the ranks of the 70% of Black children born out of wedlock, not to mention that raising a child alone is hard. Do you think I should wait until the right man comes along or really consider the SMC option? You have my permission to share this on your channel. If you do, please refer to me as X. Okay, so first off, X, I'm so glad that you enjoyed the show. Thank you so much for listening and supporting. And first off, I'm so sorry to hear about the loss of your fiance. That is such an awful thing to experience, especially at such a tragic, sudden circumstance. So my heart really goes out to you, and I'm sending lots of love and positivity your way. So you're saying now that you're single and you're in your mid-30s without children, you're seriously considering whether you should become what's called a single mother by choice, because your biological clock is ticking. Okay, so I wanted to really reflect on this one, and that's why it took me a while to get back to you. So this is coming from a person who was a single mother for years. And so what I will say is, please think extremely long and hard before you do something like this. So I think prior to having children, we really underestimate how hard it is to raise children. And we kind of have an idea, but until you're actually in the midst of it, you really have no idea how much of a labor of love and immense amount of blood, sweat, and tears that goes into raising children. So Brian from Sinji's channel even said it himself, raising children is difficult to do when you're married, let alone if you're trying to do it alone. It's such a difficult task. And the women who are able to do it, that's such an incredible feat. That's so true. And I think that there's a reason why traditionally there's supposed to be a nuclear familial unit with a mother and father before having kids. So it really takes both parents to do it well. It really does. And even, you know, then you'll hear people say, well, you need a village too. And I'm not saying it's not possible. There's lots of women who are managing to do a great job raising their children on their own. Anything is possible. You know, I'm just saying it's extremely difficult to do it the right way when you're doing it alone. And this is coming from a single mother, a person who was a single mother for years. So I want to talk about how raising children is really a major physical undertaking. So let's just start with the physical demand. So you're giving your body up to, you know, conceive this child and carry this child for 9 months. Sometimes you're even risking your life or sacrificing your life when you decide to give birth to children, because we know that Black women statistically are more likely to die while in the process of childbirth. I had preeclampsia and almost died with my son, so I fall in that statistic. That's not uncommon. And thankfully, you know, a lot of women do make it, but that's just the beginning. After that fact, you have to, you know, actually survive the recovery after giving birth. So I had a C-section, so it was not an easy recovery process for me. There's women who have to wear diapers. You're depleted hormonally and you're not thinking the same way. Biologically, some different things are happening. So you're more susceptible to depression, and a lot of women go through postpartum due to those changes. You're gaining tons of weight. If you're breastfeeding, your body isn't even yours any longer. You're literally using it to nutritionally sustain another human being. It is a lot. It's very taxing, and I couldn't imagine experiencing all of that alone. Then you think about the emotional stress. So, you know, there's postpartum depression, like we briefly talked about. You're sleep deprived and you're irritable. And it's not uncommon to be depressed and anxious and stressed. That's very common. And that's common even when you have a partner. In this situation, you'd have no partner to help you through that experience. So you'd be the sole person that's dealing through, you know, the sleepless nights. You wouldn't even have, you know, a partner to help tag team things, to help change your diaper every now and again, to help prepare, you know, bottles or whatever. You wouldn't even have that partner, that support system to kind of vent, you know what I mean, to vent to them and to unload. You'd be waking up through the night and doing all of this on your own. And I just can't emphasize enough how that's very difficult, even when you're married. I was married and my ex was the biggest loser, but he did attempt to be involved once we were together at first, and it was still very very extreme experience. Then you think about the financial burden that you're dealing with. So you'd still have to work since you would be a single mother, which is hard for a lot of moms because you're trying to work balancing, you know, working and raising a child on your own. You said you're an educator. I'm not sure how much educators earn or what your situation is like, but children are extremely expensive. And living off a single income, regardless of what you do while raising children, is very, very hard to adequately afford everything. So here where I live, daycare is easily $1,500 a month. I don't know about you, but you know, we make a comfortable living, but that's a significant expense for most people. For us, that's, you know, that's something that's not anything to dismiss. You know what I mean? That's someone's mortgage and rent money. You know, if you're doing it right and you're funding their college educations, making sure that they're involved in extracurricular activities, making sure that they're properly have the proper nutrition and clothing, and they're getting, you know, the good schools, and you're giving them adequate care. Statistically, they say easily you're looking at spending near $200,000 to $300,000 to raise a single child correctly from birth to the age of 18. So that's a lot of money to be expecting to go out, to expend, especially on a single income. And put it like this, my husband and I, we are both extremely happy. We both make very good money. We have lucrative careers. We both make six figures. He doesn't have any kids at all. And we've both decided it is not the right time to expand our family because it's such a big sacrifice. So, and then another thing I would think about that I don't think a lot of people do prior to having children is you have to consider what the child, what their upbringing is going to be like and how they're going to feel psychologically not having a father. So, and being intentionally brought into this world without another parent. Kids don't ask to be here. My mom used to always say that. That's one thing. She didn't have much wisdom, but that's one thing that she said that really resonated with me. Children don't ask to be here. And like you said, statistically, Black children, you know, they don't have fathers. I think the stat that you said was 70% Black children born out of wedlock. And statistically, those children struggle a lot. And it, you know, they have a lot of psychological issues, a lot of complexes, a lot of questions. And it is, like I said, and I want to emphasize this, it's possible for a potential child to not deal with those issues, but it's extremely likely that they will have some difficulties growing up. Personally, I'm very resentful of my parents for birthing me into poverty. I just am. And, you know, that's something that I just don't understand. My father continues to have children till this day, even though he's 56 damn years old. He has a 4-year-old running around here. And I'm sitting here looking at him like, didn't nobody sign up for this fool? Didn't nobody, you know, knock on your balls and say, let me out? I didn't ask to be here. And here you are bringing all these children into poverty. You know, my father is living off of government assistance till this day. And it's frustrating to be brought into a situation and not be able to provide the proper support for them, whether that be emotionally, you know, having that father figure, and to have to experience those struggles when you did not ask to be here. So I would consider that too, you know, and I know we see celebrities do the artificial insemination, but we can't compare our lives to them because their circumstances are so different. So they have millions of dollars, and that means that they can afford a team of people to help support them and to help fill in the gaps for, you know, the void of not having a second parent. So, you know, they have access to the best schools that the world has to offer. They have access to nutritionists and to private chefs and to live-in nannies who can help bear the burden of, you know, the burden of taking care of a child as a single parent. So I really do think that, you know, that comparing ourselves to celebrities who are able to do that, you know, that's like comparing apples and oranges. They have a lot of support and are able to help fill in a lot of the void that's felt as a result of a child not having a father. So again, I would just think very long and hard about your decision. I would go to therapy if I were you, just like you know that they have premarital counseling that people attend before getting married. I'm sure they probably offer some form of preemptive, like maybe adoption counseling or counseling for those who are considering artificial insemination, just to make sure you're really unpacking things and that you're really very clear on, you know, what you're signing up for. I have a friend who She's barren and she's married and everything, and you know, went through the adoption process over and over again and failed miserably, you know, went through a lot of ups and downs. Well, finally, she's 37, I believe she just turned. She finally was able to successfully adopt, and she's gotten two twin girls. And she talks very vocally about how she feels very guilty because she's drained, she's tired, and sometimes she does regret the decision of adopting two children because it's hard and she got a whole damn husband. So that's what I will say, especially because you're admittedly saying you are a pygmisha and a mammy and a mule. Those were your words. So I don't want y'all to think that I said that, but I don't think it's odd based on that, that you are seriously considering voluntarily becoming a single mother. Because, you know, being a full-time worker and raising a child, you know, you're used to doing everything alone all the time. You're used to being superwoman and handling everything on your own and being everything to everybody. Even, you know, like you said, you were carrying everything on your own in your previous relationship. So this, I really do think that's probably why you're drawn to the idea of doing this on your own. I would just take your time. Be very, very intentional, be very careful, be very cautious, because being a parent is a huge emotional and physical and mental and financial undertaking. It is. And that's when you're doing it with a husband, let alone when you're single. And one thing quickly before we move on, I think that in the Black community, we tend to focus on the one-off, one in a million success stories that we hear, instead of looking at the bigger picture. So, you know, we'll be like, oh, well, you know, LeBron James, he was raised by a single mother. And now, you know, he's the world's most successful athlete. He's a multimillionaire. If you fall in that 70% statistic of Black children born out of wedlock, you're probably thinking to yourself, I was fine. I grew up in a single parent home and I'm good. Even me, you know, I know a lot of people look at me and they're like, oh, well, you know, she grew up impoverished and without a father inside the home, and you know, she has multiple degrees and a successful career, y'all. So for every single LeBron James, there's millions of Pookies and Ray Rays who weren't so lucky and who are locked up right now and who had a much more difficult time because they were raised without a father. Even me, you know, I'm one in a million in my family. I'm a first generation college student, as a matter of fact. Shoot, I'd say maybe 70%, 80%. No, not even 80%. That's an underestimate. Probably 90% of my family don't even have GEDs. And you know what I'm saying? So we all come from the same upbringing, the same background, but I happen to be one of the lottery winners that made it. But statistically, if we look at the bigger picture, typically children who grow up like that, they don't fare well. So I really do think that as a community, we need to focus on doing the things that statistically contribute to success instead of the opposite. And you know, we like to pray for the best. So and this, again, this is coming from a single mother who, you know, who's been there. And I should have done that. I should have, you know, been very careful. And I had to take a sobering look in the mirror and tell myself, like, girl, you done effed up. Life is going to be an uphill battle for you, and you're just going to have to deal with it. Because we know that children who come from nuclear familial units, they fare better in life. They just do. So we should try to do the things that will help them statistically fare better and have them, you know, be brought into this world with a firm familial foundation. We should also, you know, make sure that there's a father figure. We know children who have fathers in the home tend to do better, especially in this community with all the bad influences that are out there in the community. So why not just do that? Try to have a father first, as opposed to doing the exact opposite and then just hoping that, you know, we cross our fingers and that things pan out well. I hope I'm making sense, sis. Again, take everything I say with a grain of salt because only you can decide what's best for you. But as someone who has had that experience and who has experienced single motherhood, that's my personal opinion. I would really, really think long and hard before doing anything like that because I'd hate for you to have such a promising, you know, future and then do something like that that's so life-changing that you can't change and go back and reverse that you would later regret. So that's my thoughts. If you guys have any thoughts or feedback for X in the chat, please do share in the comment section and in the chat. Thank you so much for listening, sis. Okay, so let's get to it. This is another installment of my daily series called The Blackistan Zoo, where we profile the dusty derelicts, crazy creatures, and animals in Blackistan. This series premieres Monday through Friday at 6:30 ET. This will be the last week of the Blackistan Zoo daily series. So starting in August, I'm going to roll out the Patreon. And what I'll do instead of doing the daily episodes on YouTube, since I struggle so much with the censorship and, you know, having my channel potentially being ruined by the trolls and things like that, I'm going to start actually doing the bonus episodes on Patreon, some of the daily episodes on Patreon. That way I can kind of give you guys my unedited, uncensored, uncut thoughts. And I'll stay tuned. I'll roll out more details on how you can sign up for the Patreon and check out the daily episodes that will be transitioning over to Patreon. Again, I'll still be on YouTube. I'll still be here. I think what I'll do is do episodes twice a week. So I'll do episodes probably on Tuesdays and Thursdays on YouTube and then move the other episodes to Patreon. So anywho, so today we're going to talk about the Destins, y'all. We're going to talk about the Destins. So your Destin, he is often found licking boots and brown nosing, kissing ass, his behavior. So Destins are extremely dusty, very dominated, very conquered men. So these are the men who are extremely submissive. They're extremely passive. And although they claim to have this major disdain of white supremacy, so-called white supremacy, and always complain about the white man and so-called oppression, this is not accurate because they love white men more than black women do, more than we do as divesters. They wish they could be them and will gladly lick the boots of those who they claim are quote unquote oppressing them. And this is why you'll see them jumping at the chance to lay down with Barnyard Becky, you know, these rejected women that no one wants within their own community. So when we think of Destins, we think of Kanye's controversial remarks when he said 400 years of slavery, that was a choice. And I am not a Kanye fan by any means. I think he's an idiot, but he had a point there. So you mean to tell me you men outnumbered these guys and were not only that, were bred to be strong and to you were built for back-breaking labor and you still didn't revolt? It sounds like a choice to me as well. We've even seen an influx of these Destins illustrate this behavior to this day, as there are photos going viral recently of men voluntarily dressing as subjugated slaves for things like rap videos and wedding engagement photos. Y'all. So notable Dusty Destin. So I think of Samuel L. Jackson's character in Django when he was truly so very happy to be a slave as long as he was able to have dominion over black women. And as long as he was able to have some semblance of power and as long as he was in master's good favor. So now we know your profile of your Destin. Let's get into these examples. The first thing I want to share with you is a Destin illustrating how he loves being subjugated and is grateful for enslavement. So let's look at this first picture. So here is Destin with his Destina. Okay. And let's read the caption. It says, "Happy Fourth. I love my country. I'm grateful for slavery too, because I wouldn't have met my white queen here. I'll be still in the jungle scratching my ass. I love America." Flag emoji, flag emoji, flag emoji, flag emoji. Do y'all see this? So y'all be thinking I be exaggerating, but I'm not. These men love being in bondage. They love being quote unquote oppressed. Based on his post, this sounds like a choice, right? So we see this Nick Nog expressing how thankful he is to have been enslaved. What an idiot. What an idiot. And this is why, again, you're not going to see me out here fighting for BLM. These men enjoy police brutality. They enjoy being conquered. They enjoy being subjugated. They enjoy catching knees to the neck. And it's like, whatever, dude, you keep doing that. You keep getting dominated. I'm going to be over here with the men with the dominion who have built the infrastructure and who possess the power, since you love that so much and you're so thankful. Okay, so I want to get into this next clip that shows a Dustin dressed up as a slave for a rap video. So this is pretty hilarious. I actually want to refresh this and I'm going to turn the music on and then we will get started.
Is not a creative choice for a music video. It's a... Now I know why Lovecraft Country didn't get renewed for season 2. Okay, HBO was finna do it, and then they saw this video and they was like, you know what? Nah, we don't want to contribute. What happened here? What was the choice? It was like, we're gonna go back, okay? We're gonna go and dress as slaves, but with ice, though. You know what? Actually, I'm gonna tell you what happened. They tried to explain it. This was on their website explaining it. Went from yes, master, to fighting for our masters, past or present. Still modern day slavery. Difference now is whips turned to cars and chains turned to diamonds. But what happened when the rabbit got the gun? Side eye emoji, zipper mouth emoji, hashtag what you up to Willis. So you get it, because usually the slavery whips, but now we call cars whips, and then chains turn to diamonds, right? Slave chains, ice. Like, I'm just rewatching this, and they really got slavery choreography. Like, watch, here the three come, they were hit with the bop, 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 and the twist. And as an artist, you are able to and have your own creative freedom to make what you want. As a consumer, we are able to say, why did you do this, though, for the eyes of the other people? Why we keep letting white people hit us with stuff? Now, why we let them hit us with stuff for creativity? Do something else. Do something else.
Do something else. Do something else. That's it. That's all we want.
I never thought I'd have to say this, but slavery is not a...
So I'm going to let this play in the background just in case it wasn't cringy enough for you the first time around. Y'all see this stupid sausage? Do y'all see this? So here these knickknacks have on slave attire. They got rags on, shackles and chains. They getting whipped. I don't know if you just saw the one with the white guy whipping them. One is even in a guillotine. Guillotine, I think is how you pronounce that. But that's what it looks like. And here they over here doing a BK bounce. With diamonds on around their neck, smiling and dancing, having a good old time. They love that ish. That's why. That's why. They enjoy this ish so much. So much so that they paid these white men to be their masters and to subjugate them in this music video. Y'all see this? They enjoy being dominated. They enjoy being conquered. They enjoy being slaves. They enjoy the security of being under another man's rule because they so damn incompetent and so damn unintelligent. It would be chaos if they were left to their own devices. So don't let them fool you with this mess about oppression and racism. This is all voluntary. A mess. Hot ass mess. Okay, so let's get to the meat and potatoes, what we came here for. So many of you guys inundated my inbox with messages about this slavery themed engagement photo shoot. So shout out to Queen who shared this with me. Shout out to I Said What I Said, Pink Cheetah Princess, and many others who passed along this story with me, y'all. Okay, so let's pull it up and let's unpack. So let's see if I can make this a little bit bigger. Y'all see this mess? Y'all see this mess? Child, so let's scroll through because this is a barrage of photos that they released that they thought this was a good idea. So here we go, this Nick Nog with his master. He's saying, the caption says, the year 1842, days passed and everything changed. Our love got stronger and stronger. He was no longer a slave. He was part of the family. Part two. So apparently there's a part one. This is a series. This is an enslavement engagement photo shoot series. Here's some more photos of him sitting down passively while she is dominating him with the damn shackles and chains and shit on his wrist. And by the way, this setting is actually a plantation. So they wanted to go all out. They wanted it to be all the way authentic. They actually photographed this on a sugar plantation where very, very likely many slaves were in bondage and actually had to work because they were enslaved. This next photo, I guess, shows him working. I don't know whether to laugh at this or just to frown in disgust. This is a mess. As someone who is a descendant of people who were enslaved, this is a mess. This is disgusting. Here they go kissing while his hands are chained together. Y'all, this is so cringy. She got her little bonnet on. She Miss Bonetta, Master Bonetta. Here he goes, new. Oh, y'all, I cannot. And here's my thing. I can't count how many times myself and other women like me who date non-Black men are called bed wenches. Many divested women are called bed wenches. That's like the go-to derogatory term. Anytime these nicknogs want to braid or degrade us, they call us bed wenches. We would never do no bull crap like posing as a slave for an engagement photo shoot. No, it's the men who date interracially where we hear these stories about, oh, yeah, she likes to call me the N-word when we in bed, and that's cool. And in porn, you'll hear them talking about BBCs and other stupid-ish like that. And it's because they have this weird obsession over skin color. They're into all that colorism stuff and fetishization. They have, you know, those odd, unusual slave fantasies and that other bull crap. That's what they get off on. Black women ain't doing that shit. Divesters would never do that. We just fall in love and marry who treat us well and want to be happy and live happily ever after. It's these Dustins, these dusty Dustin eggnogs out here doing a whole engagement photo shoot on a whole damn plantation. Again, that very likely had actual slaves in bondage that worked there, that died there, and he over there pretending to be a slave. What a slap in the face to the ancestors. Is this what Karen Samuels means when he says that non-Black women have better attitudes? Is this what the Save Yourself Black Men sector in the manosphere sector, is that what they all mean when they say that these women make better wives? Because they'll have you walking around just like Toby from the Roots, calling them master-ish. Y'all here looking crazy. Y'all are looking crazy, dude. Dustin, you looking crazy. And I've heard this is not uncommon. Apparently a lot of these couples and couples like this, they love to have weddings on actual plantations. They love that. And these Nick Dogs, you know, they have big Kool-Aid smiles in the pictures and they're having a grand old time because they love being in bondage. They love being conquered. They love being dominated. They enjoy that shit. They get off on that shit. So this is your Dusty Dustin, child. I can't. Again, so when we had these detractors coming over here talking about, oh, you bad wench, oh, you done sold out to the white men, and when they complain about oppression and when they complain about being, you know, facing adversity and racism, ignore them. Because they love that shit. They have these weird BDSM fantasies, these weird racial fetishes, these weird slave fantasies. So much so that they out here shucking and jiving, having a grand old time in music videos, pretending to be slaves. And they're having whole marital photo shoots acting as slaves. And they're paying people for this ish. Stay away from these Dustins, y'all. All right. That's all I got. Until next time. See you guys. Bye.
If y'all come across a red iPhone, can you please bring it to the soundstage? Red iPhone, appreciate it.